clinical database, the database becomes the basic soil, like basic ground for writing the papers later. The most important aspect of building a database registry is choosing the patient population. The young urologists are most likely to accumulate.
Halo, selamat sore. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Berjumpa lagi dengan saya, Harina Raharjo, dalam Instagram Live Perkina episode 4, di mana saya hari ini akan kedatangan tamu spesial, yaitu Profesor Sung Jun Oh dari Korea Selatan. Beliau adalah Kepala Departemen Urologi di Seoul National University Hospital. Beliau ini juga adalah seorang klinisi yang berkecimpung di bidang functional urology dan incontinensia urin. Dan beliau pertama kali datang ke Jakarta menjadi guest speaker di acara pertemuan ilmiah tahunan Perkina di tahun 2018. Dan di saat tersebut beliau mengusulkan dan juga mengundang dan mensupport kami untuk menjadi anggota Pan Pacific Continent Society. Dan di tahun 2019, tahun depannya, kami bertemu kembali di Korea dalam suatu acara ilmiah. Saya bersama dengan Dr. Vina, yaitu Sekretaris Perkina. Dan beliau memperkenalkan kami dengan Presiden PPCS Pan Pacific Continent Society saat itu, yaitu Profesor Vincent Tse dari Australia. Sehingga kami akhirnya diundang ke Sydney, Australia di tahun yang sama untuk menghadiri pertemuan ilmiah tahunan PPCS. Dan akhirnya alhamdulillah kami diterima sebagai anggota ke-6 PPCS dan anggota pertama dari Asia Tenggara. So, let me see if Professor O is already here. Yes, he is. Okay. Hello.
Hi, Dr. Harina. How
Hello,
are you?
Hello, Professor Po. How are you today?
Yeah, fine, thank you. And you?
Yeah, fine, thanks.
I know that you, today is your birthday. Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Po. So I was just telling the audience that you are the head of the Department of Urology in SNUH. And you are working in the functional urology, neurourology, and incontinence field. And we met in 2018 when you came first to Jakarta to be a guest speaker for us for the Indonesian Continence Society, who's turning 20 years this year. So this is a very special edition. So what do you think, Professor, in the last 20 years, what do you think of the development or the changes in the incontinence field and the neurourology and functional urology? Do you think there has been many changes or not? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. First of all, I'm very pleased to be invited to this live event and also have an opportunity to talk to you with the Indonesian urologist. And congratulations on the 20th anniversary of the Indonesian Continence Society. I hope that many Indonesian doctors will share their knowledges and experience with each other through the Indonesian Continence Society. And I also look forward to Indonesian Continence Society playing very major role in establishing the accurate diagnosis and treatment guidelines for patients in Indonesia too. And also I hope the Indonesian Continence Society will contribute to academic research in the field of urinary tract dysfunction worldwide. So I think the meeting 2 years ago in Jakarta was a very successful event with a very good academic program that were very comparable to those of a large international meetings such as International Continent Society. I think the members of the participant on the spot was huge, and the audience's enthusiasm was great. And I returned to Korea with a very good impression and memory. I think a lot of changes has occurred in the field of low urinary tract dysfunction over the past 20 years. The Korean Continent Society was established in 1991. It can be said that the KCS, or Korean Continent Society, is almost 30 years old. In the early days, we started out as an avoiding dysfunction study group, which is a very small group of several people discussing the cases of neurogenic bladder patients with a spinal cord injury, which are difficult to diagnose and treat. Then the TBT surgery for female stress urinary incontinence came out in mid-1990s, and this area developed very rapidly in Korea. It can be said that the TBT surgery became the major opportunity for the development of the KCS society. And after that, the prostatic laser surgeries came out. For example, the HOLAP surgery, holmium laser enucleation of prostate surgery, came out. And a new treatment such as InterStim or the sacral neuromodulation came out and received great attention. Through these processes, KCS, the status has gradually been firmly established. Although the development of new treatment has been a little bit slow in recent years, it can be said that the group of experts specializing in low urinary tract dysfunction is firmly formed in Korea. Yes.
Yeah. And I also told the audience that you were the president of the Pan-Pacific Continent Society, I believe, in 2016 until 2017, if I'm not mistaken. And we are very grateful because you introduced us to this organization, and then you supported us so that we can become a member, the sixth member of the PPCS. Can you tell us a little bit about this organization, Prof?
Yes, I remember meeting Professor Harina. You, for the first time, was in academic seminar held in Japan about 10 years ago. And it ended up talking a little while, but I remember that moment very well. Let me briefly tell you about the PPCS history. In 2001, during the annual meeting of the International Continent Society in Seoul, Korea, one of our society founder, Won-hee Park, Professor Won-hee Park, the president of KCS at that time, invited about 10 key members of the Japanese Neurogenic Bladder Society, or JNBS, and agreed on the necessity of exchanging academic information between Korea and Japan. And then in 2003, the JNBS president decided to have a KCS and JNBS joint meeting. So the following year, in 2004, the first Japan-Korea joint meeting on incontinence or continent was held in Tokyo, Japan. The second Korea-Japan joint meeting was held in 2005 in Seoul. And then Taiwan attended as an observer at that meeting. 2 years later, 1 year later, in 2006, the Taiwan officially joined as a member country, and the joint meeting was named as formerly PPCS meeting. After that, the China joined, followed by the Australia and New Zealand. In this way, the number of member country has increased. The PPCS was held has been held regularly once a year, and the host city is rotating. As it was held in Beijing, China in 2016, the regulation or the bylaw of the PPCS was established and the PPCS was further consolidated. I became the first chairman, president of the PPCS organization in 2016, and I held the PPCS in Seoul in the fall of 2017. Because I was the first president of the PPCS society, I tried to form the groundwork for PPCS. For example, establishing the first steering committee, which consists of members from each country. And also I created a PPCS homepage, and I also created the PPCS logo. So in August 2018, I met Professor Harina again for the first time since I met in Japan at the All About Incontinence Symposium in Jakarta. I proposed to Professor Harina to join the PPCS, and Professor Harina said that Indonesia is ready. So 2 months later, in October of that year, the PPCS meeting was held in Hualien, Taiwan. At the steering committee meeting, I talked about Indonesia is hoping for joining to PPCS. As it has the name of the Pan-Pacific, I said that PPCS should be expanded to encompass the Asia. Eventually, it was decided that the Indonesian representative can attend at the PPCS steering committee meeting as an observer in 2019. So the following year, the PPCS meeting was held in Sydney, Australia in 2019. The Indonesia was the first to join the PPCS in Southeast Asia. Subsequently, several countries such as Thailand or Hong Kong are also, as far as I know, hoping to join the PPCS organization. So Indonesia is very a big country. Actually, Indonesia is a country with a very large population. And in this sense, I think the demand for diagnosis and treatment of patients with low nitric dysfunction will also be very high. And Indonesia is also a very rapidly developing country. I think that the role of the Indonesian Continental Society will grow more and more at this opportunity. And Indonesia is a country where my brother lives personally, and this is also a big part of my hope for Indonesia to go very well. The Asia is a very large population, has very large population, and ethnically different from Western countries. Also, the socioeconomic situation is very different from Europe or the United States or the other continent. So I think the regional exchange within Asia is very important in diagnosing and treating diseases in this environment. In this sense, there must be a regional academic organization different from a global conference. So I think that through such an PPCS organization, a lot of knowledge and experience can be shared more efficiently.
So thank you very much, Professor Oh, for supporting us to be the member of the PPCS. I think it is a very, very good collaboration with the international continent societies. And I read that you were also the president of the Korean Continent Society the same year as 2016. So why do you think these societies are important, Professor, and how does this society embedded into your other societies, for example, the Korean Urological Association? And then Does it include a multidisciplinary specialist, including nurses also?
Yes, basically South Korea has a population of 50 million and a total number of urologists are 3,000. Among them, there are a total of 200 active members of the Korean Continental Society. Not only is the KCS open to urologists but and other medical professionals, but it is also open to other non-clinicians like nurses and technicians, whose the subspecialty area is in the lower urinary tract dysfunction. Training residents can become associate members. In this sense, the KCS is not affiliated to the Korean Urological Association, but it includes a wide range of members, non-urological members, and also the paramedics. In Korea, it is strictly divided in, by specialty field. Of course, if the hospital is not large, one may have two or three subspecialty field, but in the larger hospitals, there tend to be more independent urinary tract dysfunction field. There are approximately one urinary tract dysfunction specialty urologist at approximately one hospital, each hospital. Because of this, it is very difficult to obtain very specialized knowledge and experience about urinary tract dysfunction in within the hospital. In this way, it was formed naturally for the neurourologist to be to come to KCS and gather and discuss together. The KCS has the committee or boards such as academic committee or publication, medical reimbursement and research and public relation and planning and strategies and treasury, education and ethics and the international affairs committees and are actively engaged in other activities. Many society academic events are major events is in are this spring symposium in April and the annual biggest meeting is usually been held in September. The annual meeting is usually held as the largest comprehensive meeting, which consists of a variety of topics. But specialty events such as a surgical workshop is held once or twice a year and generally consists of a surgical video presentation or active live surgeries with a very hot discussion among the members. What is unique is that there are separate meetings for low urinary tract dysfunction nurses.
Okay.
These nurse practitioners' workshop is held to fulfill their practical and academic desires. These topics are covered because they are in charge of the CIC education or the performing the urodynamic studies or assisting urodynamic studies or the boarding diary recording education or behavioral therapy and biofeedbacks. So in December, a case conference is usually held along with the year-end party. The case conference mainly consists of a discussion on difficult cases. Each hospital is supposed to bring clinical cases of hard to diagnose or treat along with the supplementary materials such as urodynamic traces or surgical videos. The experts discuss these cases very freely and very interactively. Notably, KCS held the 31st International Continental Society meeting in Seoul in September 2001, as I already mentioned. In addition, KCS publishes professional books for the nurses and the neurourologists, and also the KCS published international English-based journals, international journals called National Neurourology Journal, or the INJ. The KCS is well known as a very active society. This seems to be because the former presidents were very active people and had a tendency to challenge. I served as a KCS president from 2016 to 2018 for 2 years, and I established the KCS mission, vision, and core values. And I also created a nurse specialist committee to further strengthen their roles.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So I want to take you back a few years, maybe, Professor. Looking back when you were a urology resident in training, did you always know that you are going to work in the functional urology or the incontinence field? Because, for example, in Indonesia, this field is not yet so established compared to, I don't know, stone surgery or endourology or oncology. So did you always know that you're going to work in this specific field?
Yes, since my residency training, I had been interested in urinary tract dysfunction field. I have been interested in the research since I was a resident, and I conducted clinical research on sexual dysfunction and urinary tract dysfunction after rectal cancer surgery. And I wrote about 3 papers, and I was so happy with the research. And the department of my department of Seoul National University Hospital, when I was a resident, has traditionally have an atmosphere that respect academic activities very much.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to the clinical studies, I was also involved in the in vitro or systometry studies using rat in an animal experiment. After completing my residency, I joined the Navy for 3 years. Since Korea is divided into North and South, and so the young, all young Koreans are, male Koreans are required to serve in the military service for 2 or 3 years. It's mandatory. After completing my military service, I studied pediatric urology and low urinary tract dysfunction and endourology while working as a fellowship training. As an animal experiment field, I did the organ-based physiological study. I prefer this field because there are small surgeries compared to the oncology. Which is big, has big surgery. However, when I started doing this neuro-urology, I had to do cystoplasty and low urinary tract reconstruction using intestine. And there were many major surgeries, so I went a little, it went a little bit different than when I originally envisioned. However, I'm very satisfied with my life now and have never regretted choosing my major. So in the future, I think the Korean society is aging, and aging population grows very rapidly in Korea. And the situation may be the same in Indonesia, because the Indonesia is a big country and also huge population and also a rapidly developing country. So in the future, in long run, I think the 10 or 20 years or 30 years, this area will become very big, I think, because many patients will, the importance and the significance of this area grow bigger and bigger, I think. Yes.
Yeah, I agree, Prof. And then in 2020, I think it is, sorry, in 2019, I visited your clinic, your department, and you have this excellent integrated clinic for functional urology. Can you explain a little bit about how you set up this kind of clinic? Because this is very important, I think, because we are trying to establish the same kind of clinic, and I think we're almost there. But can you explain to us how did you start and what were the obstacles and so on?
Yes. In the managing the low urinary dysfunction patient, it is very important that the diagnostic process and the treatment process are very well organized and it's very well connected. Diagnostically, it is necessary to establish a robust system, a very solid system for urodynamic testing. In terms of treatment, the drug therapy and surgery, and in between the behavioral therapy, or CIC or biofeedback, these are very important parts. In 2000, when I was appointed as an assistant professor at Seoul National University Hospital and started my career in neuro-urology area, it was my first time in this hospital as an independent low urinary dysfunction field. At that time, there was very, very few basics, such as the research and treatment. Mm-hmm. So I had to do, I had to establish this infrastructure of my own independently. There was two main things I pushed forward at that time. Of course, it was not done in a very short period of time, and it took me about 4 or 5 years to complete establish. First, I built the urodynamic system, which is a fluoroscopic system, and I purchased two new urodynamic testing equipment and also the fluoroscopic equipment, and I made two study rooms, the space, and I also had two urodynamic specialist nurse. Mm-hmm. The good protocol, the performing the urodynamic protocol, has been established entirely in accordance with the ICS standardized protocol.
Yeah.
And since many patients with the intractable or very difficult low urinary dysfunction patient come to the Seoul National University Hospital because the SNUH, my hospital, is the tertiary referral center. The urodynamic testing is very important for diagnosis for these patients. So the establishment of urodynamic system enables sophisticated treatment. The neurogenic bladder patient, the use of fluoroscopic system, if possible, can greatly improve diagnostic accuracy.
Mm-hmm.
A great deal of effort has been put into advancing the quality of the improving the quality of the practice of urodynamic specialists or the nurses. For the first 5 years, I actually have held a weekly urodynamic test conference to increase the communication with the urodynamic nurses. So, mm-hmm. and also the training residents. So I'm very confident that the quality of urodynamic study result is very high in my hospital. Second, I created the urodynamic low urinary tract dysfunction patient education system. I have created one, actually made the one special nurse manpower. She is a nurse in charge of the CIC education to patients. with the emitting failure, and she is also in charge of the biofeedback and behavioral therapy, and also the teach people how to record the voiding diary. And the importance of the CIC education in patient with the neurogenic bladder is it cannot be overemphasized. Important. I think this is the most basic treatment tool. I thought it was necessary to establish guideline for this treatment. Even if CIC training is given to the patient, once the patient cannot, the patient compliance is not very high, the patient cannot easily follow.
Yeah.
I have seen so many patients who always have problems and have a serious complication due to failure to follow up the proper CIC protocol. And I made sure the patient do CIC in the correct way. Fortunately, I can say that I met good people such as the urodynamic specialist nurse and also the CIC education nurse. It was very lucky for me. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it took some time, right, Prof? It didn't happen like one night, but it took some time, like a few years, mm-hmm. few years to establish a good integrated clinic. So we have been talking about the history. Now we're going to talk about the future. What do you see in another 20 years? I mean, the management of incontinence generally in the future. What are your vision or what are your hopes are?
Yes, I think the followings are my the parts that I will will contribute to the lower tract dysfunction field. I am thinking that I will probably continue to treat the lower urinary tract dysfunction patient for the next 20 years. For the remainder of the year, I want to improve the diagnosis and treatment of these problem patient with the lower urinary tract dysfunction and incontinence. And I would like to further improve neurogenic bladder management in the patient, especially in the group of patients with a spinal cord injury, neurogenic bladder. The spinal cord injuries are also socially, the patients are underprivileged, and also they have a very complex conditions with many complications. Of course, in particular, my particular interest is in the development of medical device as a field other than neuro-urology. For the past 7.5 years, I was in charge of the medical device research and development at the Seoul National University Hospital. During this period, I played a role in accelerating medical device development by mediating the engineers and the manufacturing companies and the clinicians. As a result, I have seen many doctors' ideas came to life in medical devices. In 2016, I developed an app that can accurately calculate the probability of surgical necessity using a database of the BPH patient with the BPH patient. Input variables are age, gender, not gender, IPSS score, the QMAX and the PVR volume and the BO index. I have also created a probability calculator that can estimate BO or not. So I want to work on making a new diagnostic tool, especially the non-invasive method, preferably in the field of lower urinary tract dysfunction. In recent years, the era of artificial intelligence has came out, Fortunately, I have a low urinary tract dysfunction clinical database accumulated over the past 17 years. So I want to make the new medical devices in this field. Yes, that's my hope. Yes.
Okay, Prof. So you are saying that data is very important if you want to do research or if you want to make some application. You really have to have a good data. And with the big data, you can do anything, actually.
Yeah.
And this is my last question, Professor. I know that Indonesia is very close to your heart because your brother lives here, I think, for many, many years. And he speaks very good Indonesian. He's very fluent in Indonesian. So do you have any messages for us, urologists, young urologists, or resident in training? Do you have any messages for us who works in this specific field?
Yes. Actually, here are some messages I would like to give to young Indonesian urologists. First, I would like to introduce my career. First, I advise the young urologists to look their career for long range. And I also would like to advise them to establish a clinical database. The database becomes the basic soil, like basic ground for writing the papers later. The most important aspect of building a database registry is choosing the patient population the young urologists are most likely to accumulate. So the young urologists, they see the patient and the large group of patients they may see, that is the target for the making the establishing the large database. In this way, the database can be quickly obtained from accumulated from the patient group. One of the things I paid attention to the last 20 years ago was building a urodynamic study database system. This is because I was doing the retrospective research when I was a resident or a fellow, and I felt desperately that how long it took to clean up the urodynamic database to make the statistical analysis. So when I started my career, professional career as an assistant professor at Seoul National University Hospital, I tried to build a database input system based on Microsoft Access. So I started entering the database in prospectively. So it has been already 17 years, and now there are more than 17,000 urodynamic database accumulated so far. Since the database of the patient are data of the patient are piled up, the research data can be easily extracted according to the specific diseases like Parkinson's diseases, and the writing the paper it can be done very easily. So in addition, there are other database registries like BPH database registry and the neurogenic bladder database registry. What I'd like to emphasize for young urologists is to set up their own database entry system initially. And second, I'd like to mention I think the exchange between the young urologists is very important. In particular, the exchange within Asia are very important. The reason is that it is geographically so close that it is, of course, the very advantageous over distant countries far away. So I think I can understand the situation very much because I have a we have the same Oriental culture. I think that there are many issues such as the rapidly growing number of elderly populations in Asian countries. As you mentioned, my brother, the brother has been doing business in Indonesia for a very long time, over more than 20 years.
Yeah.
I'm very he is very fluent in Indonesian language. For this reason, I also feel a special relationship with Indonesia. The last year, the urology professors, Professor Chaidir Mohta and Irfan Wahudi and the Nur Rashid from RSCM Hospital visited our Seoul National University Hospital. And Professor Harina is also, she visited, you visited my hospital. I hope that such exchanges will continue to be active and become the relationship between Korea and Indonesia will grow more and more in terms of the academic area and also the nationally. The Professor Harina is so active, I know. That and also academically, she's very strong, and I believe the Professor Harina will lead the Indonesian Continental Society very well, and I wish you good progress and success. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor. Yeah. I think this was a really interesting and really inspiring for us all. So thank you very much for joining us in our Instagram Live episode 4. This session will be recorded and will be uploaded on our YouTube channel, Perkina. And don't forget to follow us on Instagram, pp.perkina. So once again, Professor I will see you again when the situation in the world gets better, I hope. And then I hope that our collaboration between our departments will continue and grow, and I'll see you later. Bye bye.
Well, thanks so much. Yeah, bye.
Bye.